We welcome to the interactive session on Stress Project Fund. May I welcome the dignitaries, Sri Deepak Goradia ji, President-elect, CREDAI-MCHI, Past President, Sri Dharmesh Jain, CREDAI-MCHI, and Mr. Irfan Kazi, CIO, SBI CAP, to come on stage, please. Members, we request you to put your hands together and welcome them. Thank you. Yes, sir, President-elect, CREDAI-MCHI.
Good afternoon, all. I hereby welcome for this interactive session with SBI CAP for the Stress Fund, the SWAMIH Investment Fund. All the members and the team of CFO and all, I welcome everyone. I welcome our guest Irfan ji, the CIO of the SBI CAP. He will be explaining the entire process of the Stress Fund, and with your further after presentation, we will be opening for the question and answers. You'll have an opportunity to interact and understand the whole process. If you recollect, the overall industry since slowdown and the projects are getting stuck, and since last 1.5 years, the availability of funds have become a big challenge in the industry. Lot of projects are stuck because of non-availability of fund. Government of India initiated the issue with the Honorable Finance Ministry, Nirmala Sitharaman ji announced the stress fund of 25,000 crore just to support the last mile funding to complete the real estate project and endeavor to give possession to the customers and unlock the value of the property. This is a golden opportunity for us to revive the industry and take it further. I welcome everyone, and I really thanks the Kazi ji and our CREDAI Nation President Shri Satish Magal ji, who has initiated the whole roadshow throughout India. It first presentation of sir began from Delhi NCR, then it moved to Hyderabad, Pune and Bangalore and various other cities. And today we have opportunity to interact directly in city of Mumbai. I request Dharmesh Jain, our past president, to say a few words.
Mr. Kazi, Deepak, and all friends. So, I think the whole industry is going through a very interesting phase, and interesting is a very mild word to use. But I've always felt these are the challenges that actually make companies, make people, and bring about the best in the given situation. It's been great to see the government respond very positively to the ground realities, and I think CREDAI has been very closely working with the government in getting them abreast with the situation on ground. The good thing about real estate is there are still number of projects which are viable, which are stuck because the last mile funding is not there. And when we talk of last mile funding, I think one thing that is a general common in real estate is that project cycles were longer and loan periods were lesser. So invariably, even though viability was there, the projects were not getting the funding to complete projects. Clearly, the slowdown in sales was also contributing to it. And so that's where CREDAI actively interacted with the government and requested that something like this should be done. And when we were chatting, I think the government has done a wonderful, wonderful job. Mr. Kazi was just telling us that they worked on Saturdays, they worked on Sundays, and in such a short span of time, this thing has come together. And I'm sure hundreds of projects, thousands of home buyers, and number of developers across the country are going to hugely benefit out of this. And most importantly, I think customers are going to get their homes. Once construction is complete, there are solutions. If you are stuck in between, then obviously all the problems are there. So I think without taking much time, all of us are here to listen to Mr. Kazi. So Mr. Kazi, most welcome. And again, as MCHI CREDAI, we would like to say that we would love to work shoulder to shoulder with you. And do whatever it takes to bridge the gap between the wonderful work you are doing and obviously the aspirations of the developers on how more and more projects can benefit out of the schemes, and the viable ones see the completion of the day. So once again, most welcome, Mr. Kazi. Thank you for taking time out, and we would love to we would love you to throw more light on this wonderful scheme. Thank you very much.
I know it's afternoon and it's stress, but still the claps can be louder.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Mr. Jain. Thank you, Mr. Goradia. I will just take you quickly through real estate. I'm very cognizant of the fact that I'm sitting here before experts, or standing here before experts. I do not need to explain Mumbai real estate to you. So I'll take the easy way out. I will explain, what the picture in real estate is at the national level. This is a national fund after all. So that's one. I'll take you through the mandate of this fund. I will give you an update on the progress we've achieved so far. And I'll also answer, as many questions as you care to ask, right? But first things first, never talk to strangers. Let me just quickly introduce myself. My name is Irfan Kazi. I'm the Chief Investment Officer of this fund. I have been in financial services generally for the last 25 years or so. More important in this context, I've been in institutional real estate investments since the sector opened up for investments in 2005. Since then, I have moved along through firms like ICICI Venture, Everstone, then called Future Capital, AIG, L&T Infra, and finally SBI CAP Ventures. Throughout this time, I have been associated only with real estate private equity funds, and it's almost in that capacity that I'm here today, right? So let me just quickly take you through this fund. Like I said, let me just generally talk about real estate. The fact that this fund has been launched, there is a perception that real estate is going through a crisis. There is most of the coffee table conversation is centered around that. Strangely, we are at a point in time when the crisis is probably actually over, right? So let me just quickly tell you what I mean by that. The market was going through a cyclical downturn till, maybe 2017. It started improving in 2018. And if 2018 was a flash in the pan or whatever, that trend has actually continued in 2019. And it has done, improved in a way at the, and these are national aggregate statistics, in a way that you guys understand it a little more than I do, which is launches have decreased, sales have improved, right? So your inventory, capital locked up, etc., your situation is far better now than what it was earlier. So why is it that when the market has started improving, people are saying that the market is going through a crisis? Actually, what they're trying to tell you is that the market has changed. What has happened in the last 1 or 2 years or more is that the market has actually recovered. But at the same time, the market has, morphed or transformed or changed. And what are the changes that have taken place in the market? Forget the fact that, sales have improved, inventory has decreased, launches have decreased, etc. Most importantly, the number of developers in the market has actually halved. So it's a fragmented industry. And there are lots of, contrasting developments happening in this sector at the same time. So we have large corporate groups entering the sector, the likes of Godrej, L&T, and so on. A large number of developers exiting the sector, and so a fragmented industry is consolidating itself. So that's one level of change that's happening in the industry. The other level of change is the consumer is changing. Consumer preferences are changing. Terminologies that we used to associate only with the capital markets are now being used with the real estate market. Flight to quality, trust deficit, and so on. Flight to quality, just when sales were, even as sales were going through a cyclical downturn, branded developers are now outselling unbranded developers. In a cost-conscious culture like India, that is big news, right? Let's not get into the details of what is a brand, but generally some, a developer that is known across areas is now selling far more than a, a one-stop shop developer, even though his product is priced at a premium. So that's a significant change in the market. The other change, and which will lead us to where the stalled fund is, and why this fund has come up is, there is a consumer preference for completed apartments. Under construction apartments are not selling. Maybe that's related to trust deficit. Maybe that's related to GST. Depending on who you are, you know, you'll attribute varying reasons for that phenomenon. But there is a definite shift in the consumer preference. Consumer now wants completed apartments. Maybe it's about trust deficit. Maybe trust, you know, he feels that the developer might not be able to complete the apartment, and therefore it pays to pay a slight premium and get into a completed apartment. At the same time, consumer preferences are changing, which means that a large number of apartments which have been made or were made in the past are no longer on the consumer's must-have list. Consumers now want, you know, those who preferred a 2 BHK want a 1 BHK. Those who preferred a 3 BHK might want a compact 2 BHK. And therefore, you know, while apartment sizes have shrunk, unfortunately, real estate cannot react that fast. There's a lag time, right? Construction has started, you know, in the last 5 years, in the last 10 years. So all that contributes to the rising inventory in the market. I don't have to tell you that affordable and mid-income markets are, you know, are surging across the country. It is the only portion of the market that is actually almost subsidizing the enthusiasm level of the developer who's stuck with, you know, some other projects, right? And of course, there's a new law in town, RERA. I will not get into it. You know, I'm sure you guys understand RERA a lot more than I do. So the preference for completed apartments, the fact that consumer preferences have changed has resulted in, you know, projects getting completely stalled. Usually the sales velocity stalls first and then construction stops because sales are supplying the fuel for construction, right? When we took on this assignment, one of the first things that we did was we did a market study on the stalled apartments in the country. So we did, we engaged a prop equity. We studied, you know, I don't quite remember, but I think it's 33, 35 markets across the country. And we've tried to estimate what is the extent of the problem. And the number we have is 4.58 lakh units. So there are 4.58 lakh units stalled in 1,509 projects across the country, 582 million square feet or so, right? So that's the problem. Now, this is where the fund comes in. How much does it take to complete those constructions, right? We have estimated, based on the market survey, that it will take about 55,000 crores to complete construction in these stalled projects. Now, that's half the story. Is it a problem of liquidity? Is it a problem of profitability? That is the biggest question to answer. Now, if these stalled projects are completed, you have inventory of 3.3 lakh crore getting released, unlocked, when these projects are completed. Some of them is sold inventory, some of them is unsold inventory. During the market study, we could not get information on, you know, if it's sold inventory, what portion of the price has already been collected. So in any sold inventory, there is something that we refer to as sold receivables, which is, you know, what portion is still to be received from the home buyer. That, unfortunately, information cannot be aggregated at a larger level because it's very private information, right? It cannot be sourced very easily. What is available, though, is the unsold inventory. Now, the unsold inventory in these projects is by itself about 1.3 lakh crores. What does this mean? It means it takes 55,000 crores to complete these projects. There is 130,000 crores of inventory that would be available after these projects are completed. So, like Mr. Jain pointed out, no denying the fact, these projects are profitable at an aggregate level. Two things. It means that it's probably a liquidity issue, that's one. Two, aggregation hides a lot of, you know, the devil is in the fine print, right? It is possible that what is true at the aggregate level might not be true for every project at the micro level. So some projects are profitable. There are also a lot of projects which are not profitable. I mentioned that the inventory stalled is about 4.58 lakh units. There are 1,509 projects which are stalled. Two important things about this, and I will not get into the finer details here, but one, it's a problem of scale, right? Fortunately or otherwise, it's also a very localized problem. So it's a very large problem, but it's concentrated in Mumbai, MMR, and NCR. NCR has about 45% or so. Mumbai has about 20% or so. Between the two, 65% of the problem is in these two places. If you look at the top 8 cities, 85% of the problem is in the top 8 cities, right? So it's a large problem, yet it's strangely a very localized problem. So that's one. The other is, if you look at the stalled projects, you know, you could always say it's a developer problem. Two things about this. Most of the projects are stalled for a long period of time. We established that a majority of the projects are stalled for at least 2 years or more. So it's a lingering problem. So that's one. The other bit is, unfortunately, about 60 to 70% of the units in these stalled projects are sold already. What does that mean? It means it's no longer a developer problem. There are home buyers who are stuck in it, right? So there is a developer issue to it, angle to it, and there is a home buyer angle to it. And this is where this fund comes in to solve the home buyer problem and thereby alleviate the problems faced by developers across the country. The fund has a very, very sharply defined mandate. Even as I define the mandate, let me just quickly tell you, and to bear in mind that what I'm telling you is the qualification criteria, it is not the funding criteria. So a project might meet the qualification criteria, and it will yet, you know, whether it's funded or not, will be an investment call taken by the investment team at SBI CAP Ventures, this SWAMIH fund that we call it. So the fund is called a SWAMIH fund because SWAMIH is, you know, an R acronym for Special Window for Affordable and Mid-Income Housing. So that's the genesis of that name. The fund is focused only on affordable and mid-income housing, like the name suggests. What is affordable and mid-income housing? We live in a country where the definition of affordable is different in every state. Even with the central government, there are, you know, 10 different definitions for what affordable housing is. The approach we took here is to define both affordable and mid-income housing by referring to two things. One is a size criteria and two is a price criteria. As I go on and tell you about it, you know, to those of who are unaware about it, you'll notice that it's a very liberal criteria. And, you know, just by that, you should understand that the intent is to do something. The intent is not to, you know, set up a window and do nothing, you know, have sharply defined criteria. So almost every other project will not meet the qualification criteria. So we've defined affordable and mid-income housing as housing less than 200 square meters, that's one. And two, you know, in a certain price bracket. Now we live in a country where affordable housing in Kolkata costs maybe 20 lakhs. In Mumbai, something less than 2 crores is considered affordable, right? So we had to define different prices for different cities. And the route we took is have a special price for Mumbai because Mumbai is different. Another price for the rest, for the top 7 cities in India, because they are still different from the rest of India, and then the rest of India. So as long as a property is less than 2 crores in Mumbai, less than 1.5 crores in the top 7 cities, and less than 1 crore in the rest of India, it qualifies as affordable and mid-income housing. Bear in mind, 1 crore in the rest of India is a very, very, very liberal criteria for defining this. So as a result of this definition, we've seen that about 94% of all stalled projects fit into this criteria. So that's how liberal and wide the definition is. We went a step further and we said 90% of the units in any 90% of the FSI in any project needs to satisfy this criteria, which means you can have 5 to 10% retail, you can have 5 to 10% penthouses, larger houses, whatever, more pricier houses, and yet the project would qualify for funding. For the first time ever, we used a term called net worth. You know, if there are CAs sitting here, net worth is a term generally used for company balance sheets. We've used it for a project where we've defined net worth as any project which is profitable, right? Now, what is profitable? To us, it's very simple. There are only two sources of inflows for any project, which is sold receivables and unsold inventory. So that's, you know, how much money will come into the project. How much money will be spent on the project is the balance cost of construction and the cost of repaying our financing. So the cost of, the proceeds from sold receivables plus unsold inventory should be greater than the cost to complete plus the cost to service our debt, right? If it meets that criteria, the project is net worth profitable. It's a simple mechanical formula, and therefore, you know, every one of us feels that we can game it. There is some thought that ultimately goes in understanding the quality of this net worth, and we'll get into that at some stage later. This project is only for brownfield projects, not greenfield projects. And by color, we are obviously talking about the stage that the project is. So it is not for projects where, you know, the ground is clear, project has not been launched. It is for projects that are at least 30% complete. And how do we decide, you know, whether a project is 30% complete? We go by a mathematical criteria. 30% of the project cost, which includes land and which includes all of the cost, if that has been incurred, project is 30% complete. The purpose of this funding. You would have heard this phrase, this is a fund to provide last mile funding for completion of stalled projects. Understand, you know, let me quickly explain what are stalled projects and what is last mile funding. By stalled projects, we obviously are not referring to a project where construction activity is continuing. We are, however, referring to a project where, you know, there is no activity on the site for the last, you know, maybe greater than 3 months. So if there's no activity on the site, that's a stalled project. We are very mindful of the fact that developers will continue activity on the site because that keeps the sales office ticking as well. So that is progress without, or that is activity without progress, right, in the project. So if the project is in a state where it looks like the RERA completion date of the project is threatened, is likely to be breached, that project could qualify as a stalled project, right? So the project, again, the project may or may not be stalled right now. It's not like we are saying, let the project get stalled, then come to us. If it's obvious from your funding sources that project is going to get stalled, maybe in the next quarter or in the next 6 months, it qualifies for funding here. So it need not necessarily be a story of the past. It can be something looking ahead as well. I also mentioned I will define last mile funding. By last mile funding, we are very clearly talking of funding which will complete a project, which will not be dependent on any excuses, any story. So when we come in, we don't have any excuses to fall back on. All those excuses are a story of the past. We are assuming status quo or something worse than this will continue. So what we assume when we look at a project is, we assume that sales are going to be either as bad as they, you know, lately were, or will be even worse going ahead. We assume that sales will happen only when construction is completed. We assume that the home buyer is not going to be very responsive when you make a capital call to the home buyer when you meet a stage of construction. So what happens is when you raise a certain slab and so on, you can call for money from the home buyer. Everybody in the industry will tell you that, let's say in the past, home buyers were delaying by a month or so before paying up. Now they are delaying by even more. In some parts of the country, home buyers are just defaulting. Right? So we are not providing a component of the total funding, a component which is dependent on money from the home buyers and from incremental sales. We are telling you that when we provide funding, we will complete the project. Right? So we come in with that assurance when we are looking at a project. We will provide, there has to be a good reason why we are not providing, let's say, 90% of the cost to complete the project. We are not looking at, you know, we are giving 25%, home buyers are giving 70%, whatever, and it all adds up to 100, which is good for your Excel worksheet or, you know, your back of the envelope calculations. And then the story changes as the mood of the country changes, right? So this is not going to be that kind of funding. Last mile funding meant to complete. The last mile starts only after about 30% of your project is complete. I think that's the other bit is RERA. Now, RERA is not a problem here, but we necessarily are looking for RERA registered projects. There are parts of the country where RERA is not completely applicable. As investors, as the government, you know, there is a lot of safety. There are a lot of clauses of RERA that we look at. So we are necessarily looking at RERA funded projects only. Just, you know, I just left out a little bit about the kind of funding we are providing. We are providing funding in the form of NCDs. So this is a alternative investment fund registered under SEBI regulations. We cannot provide a loan. So what do we do? We provide a loan which is in the form of a security. That's called a non-convertible debenture. So we provide you funding in the form of a non-convertible debenture. Our emphasis when we are providing the funding is not so that you service the funding with our with the money we provide you, right? So there were days and there were times when we would provide you funding, we would also provide you for the money to repay the interest and so on. This is not that kind of funding. The entire purpose of the funding is to complete construction. So the funding can be used only for one thing, which is to complete construction. Now, what is construction expense? Is buying of additional FSI construction expense, is paying sales brokerage construction expense. We've chosen to define what is construction expense by exclusion, right? So I think in the Companies Act or somewhere, I could be wrong here, but a public limited company was defined as a company which is not a private limited company, right? So the Act had several criteria for what a private limited company is, and then defining a public limited company was any company which is not a private limited company is a public limited company. Likewise here, you know, that was the inspiration for the definition of construction expense here. Any expense which is not used to repay a financial liability of another debtor is construction expense. It could be GST, it could be taxes, it could be duties, it could be sales and brokerage expenses, architect fees, additional FSI purchase that is required, approval expenses, any expense which is not related to repayment of another debtor's liability. So this funding cannot be used to repay any other financial debtor that is there in your project. It cannot be used to service their interest. It cannot be used to service their principal. It cannot be used to buy them out. It cannot be used to provide them an escape route. So this is, you know, providing an escape route to home buyers. As a result, developers are also benefiting. We are hoping that the same benefit will then get translated into NBFCs and banks, because their non-performing assets are now completed and therefore cash flow starts happening. We are hoping that that will also trigger employment in a big way. We are hoping that it will also lead to a demand for, you know, all the construction commodities, steel, cement, etc. And just before I say thank you, since I had just moved on to that slide, the maximum funding that we can provide for any project is 400 crores. So again, that's a big number. We can even provide up to 800 crores to any one developer. This is a diversification norm. And in terms of citywide exposure, we are looking at about a maximum of 40%. And that golden number of 40% has come from the fact that, let's say, NCR has 40% of the total stalled market in the country. So it's at this stage where, you know, the floor is open to questions. Like I mentioned earlier, I'll answer as many as you care to ask. And if I don't know the answers, I'll get back to you. Yeah. So I was hoping you would not have noticed it, but you did. So my apologies, actually. When I was talking of the funding, we are providing funding in the form of NCDs. Let me give you a very long answer to it. If you want a short answer, it's about 15%. But let me give you a long answer to it, right? Like I said, the entire funding is to be used for construction. So we are not expecting any monthly, quarterly coupon or anything. Those are IRR-based NCDs. That is, the interest rate will accrue. You know, that's what IRR is. It will accrue. It will be payable only when the construction is complete. Till then, even, you know, any receivables that come in from sold inventory, any incremental inventory that is sold, all that money will be diverted. And, you know, diversion is not such a good word, but it will be diverted for construction. It will not be used for repayment of our liability. So there is no financial payment and all inflows in the project will be used to complete construction.
To include the approval expenses also, to be paid to MCGM, MMRDA.
All legitimate expenses.
Perfect. Now we're talking about those. Also, is there any clarity about the NCLT proceedings with the existing lenders? Because this money, like you said, is not even servicing your loan. In the case of a senior lender already in the project, if you're not servicing theirs because of the norms, won't they go into a situation where that'll become an NPA?
So, in terms of cause and effect, they are anyway getting into a situation where it's an NPA. We are not causing it, right? What we are doing is, and the only difference we are making it, Right now there is a project where, you know, status quo could continue, and that, you know, if it's not already an NPA, it will become an NPA, or if it's an NPA, it becomes a loss asset going ahead. What we are doing is, we are coming in, we are completing construction. So in terms of the physical nature of what you are doing, we are actually completing a project. In terms of the accounting nature, you are right. Because we are not letting money to go for servicing of the debt, the underlying debt, if it's not already an NPA, will become an NPA. But just understand the cause and effect. We are not causing it to become an NPA.
No, that's not the point. But just that with the taxpayer money, now we'll go to NCLT.
Yeah.
There's a risk of that happening?
Yeah.
Okay.
So there's a risk of that happening. And we see that happening in most of these projects. And we are quite okay with it.
In a real situation where the lenders are in liquidation, let's not name them, but we all know there is an administrator appointed. Now, so hypothetically, you give a sanction and you try to get an NOC from the existing administrator, there is nobody to even decide. In a existing NBFC with people already there in the office, they might be able to take a decision of giving you abeyance to the repayment and abeyance to the interest payment, because they are assured by way of a second charge or whatever. But in this kind of deadlock situation, how do you, because it is for you also, if somebody goes to NCLT, the whole process, your money as well as the existing money and the project, everything gets stuck.
So what we've done is, this funding is designed to survive NCLT proceedings, right? What used to happen earlier, I said we come in as priority funding. Priority funding means that we are the last in, we are the first out. In case the project does not go through NCLT, the process is we sign an inter-creditor arrangement with the other creditors in the project. They all agree to our superiority. They all agree that our money will be used for construction. They all agree that it's only after we get repaid that any money will go to them. So that's the normal situation. If it goes into NCLT, what used to happen earlier is the committee of creditors didn't necessarily have to recognize an inter-creditor arrangement. It didn't necessarily have to recognize priority funding. And therefore, no one was ready to do priority funding. The government has come out with an amendment to the bankruptcy code where funding from the SWAMIH fund will be recognized as priority funding even in and through NCLT proceedings. So we'll continue to retain our priority status, and therefore we are, you know, in a manner of speaking, almost unaffected by the company going into NCLT.
One more question. On the 30% cost of the project already incurred, now, for example, because the project is stuck, last 15-18 months, hardly any money was available to the sector from NBFCs, even committed monies have not been disbursed. So obviously, the whole projects have taken beating, and obviously because of that lack of confidence and all, sales also have not happened. But let's say the project has already crossed 50% of the project cost and all. In such situation, how does your processing team look into the, because the first question is sales velocity. So if that is the question, then the whole scheme of things don't survive.
We understand that the whole reason the project is stalled is, you know, sales didn't happen, right? That could be the prime contributor. There could be a million other reasons, but that's, you know, more likely than not one of the reasons why the project is stalled. And that's why we mentioned that when we are looking at providing the funding, we will assume that kind of velocity to continue even after our funding comes in. We are hoping it's not the case, but at least for the case for the sake of planning and providing for, we'll assume that kind of velocity, close to zero velocity, will continue even after we provide the funding. And that will continue till the project is completed. Only after that, sales velocity will pick up. So that by itself is not determinant on whether we'll do the project or not.
Coming back to NCLT, so like, for example, if you want to fund a project and there is already a lender sitting. So any process is to be done by the borrower to go to that lender to get an NOC or keep the whole matter in abeyance or any, I mean, will you need any such kind of things, or is it advisable for the borrower to be in sync with the existing lender? Because see, somebody is going to try and do mischief the moment they see the money coming in the project.
So clearly, we are looking at a reference from the existing lender. So if your company has an existing lender, we are looking for a reference, and by a reference we mean either the lender sends us the case or you come to us with the case and you tell us you've already spoken to the lender, and then we speak to the lender and we are assured that the lender is okay with the SWAMI fund coming in and providing priority funding. If that is the case, only then we continue processing the application further.
And what happens in a case like DHFL, which is now going to administrator?
So that is the loan exception to which, you know, I don't have any clear answer. The only thing is we are already looking at a couple of cases which are from the from somewhere there, where, you know, action of the administrator is required, and we are relying on the company and the investment banker and the people who've shown us the deal to get the approvals required.
Thank you so much.
How you determine the tenure of the project and tenure of the funding?
So first thing is, we are looking at projects which are at least 30% complete. Two, we are not looking at funding projects where, you know, let's say if there are 5 buildings that are in various stages, they've been launched, they are in various stages of construction. That is phase 1. And in phase 2, you know, 6 more buildings are to be launched. So when we come in, we'll provide funding only for the first 5 which are already launched. So as a rule, we'll provide funding only for projects where there is already a home buyer interest involved. Number of home buyers is a matter of discussion, project specific, etc. But if a project has, you know, some buildings have not been launched, we will not consider it. So now we are looking at those 5 buildings which are, you know, at least 30% complete. We are estimating that it will take about 2 to 3 years to complete them with no stoppage due to lack of funding. So we are providing funding which will continue supporting the construction for at least 2 to 3 years, and we'll look at getting our money back for another 2 to 3 years. So sales happening primarily after that. It is good if sales happen earlier, but we are saying in the worst case, sales happening after that, so that the total duration of the funding will be about 5 to 6 years.
Correct. So when you are doing a financial closure, you are giving the balance funding, then you will consider the aggressive construction schedule, or you will go with the pessimistic construction schedule?
So the way we build cost and provide for cost is with a very passive, you know, very conservative schedule, and then we'll hope you can speed it up because funds are available, right? So that the funding in the end turns out to be more than what you require rather than less than what you require.
Okay, thank you.
सर मेरा दो पॉइंट था. एक तो मेरी कंपनी एनसीएलटी में है, ऑलमोस्ट 1300 लोगों को घर देना है, कोई एप्लीकेंट नहीं आया, 15 महीना गया, आई एम द एप्लीकेंट 29A. आज के दिन में काम हमने बार्टर सिस्टम में भी काम चालू रखा हुआ है, तो 1300 लोगों में बजट है सबका 25 लाख, 15 लाख, 20 लाख. अभी तक एप्लीकेंट हमने देने के बाद 3 महीने से वोटिंग नहीं हो रहा है, उस टाइम पे हमको किस तरह से एज आरपी अपना एप्लीकेशन करे, एज ए मे एप्लीकेंट तो मैं एप्लीकेशन कर सकता हूँ, कौन कर सकता है? माय कंपनी इज एनसीएलटी.
सो द रेफरेंस ऑफ योर कंपनी शुड कम टू अस. इफ योर कंपनी इज ऑलरेडी इन एनसीएलटी, इट शुड कम टू अस फ्रॉम द कमिटी ऑफ क्रेडिटर्स.
आरपी आ सकता है या कमिटी, सीओसी या रीजनल प्रोफेशनल,
बोथ कैन कम टू अस.
ओके,
कम टू अस एंड से कि वी वांट, यू नो, वी वांट एसबीआई कैप वेंचर्स द स्वामी फंड टू लुक एट दिस प्रोजेक्ट. We will see if the fund meets our funding criteria. If it does, then we can provide the funding.
Okay. Another, मेरा एक कंपनी है जो NPA हुआ है, जिसमें 20 करोड़ में सेंक्शन था IOB बैंक का, 14 दिया, 6 नहीं देने से काम स्लो हो गया, और 14 करोड़ में से मैंने 11 करोड़ लौटा दिया. अभी 3 करोड़ रुपया है, मेरा सिक्योरिटी 25 करोड़ की है, प्रोजेक्ट 100 करोड़ का है, कस्टमर उधर 600 लोग हैं, ऑलमोस्ट 80% काम पूरा हो गया, फिनिशिंग चालू है. तो IOB NPA है, एज अ मैं डायरेक्टर हूँ, तो उसमें मुझे कैसे एप्लीकेशन करना होगा?
So again, you need to tell IOB to refer that case to us, or you can get the project to us. After you've discussed it with IOB and confirmed that they are willing to look at this, at SWAMIH funding. IOB, you know, I can stick my neck out and say will be willing to look at it for two reasons. They are also an investor in our fund, and two, the fact that it's an NPA, right? So if it's an NPA, the bank is not going to provide additional funding. We are willing to provide you additional funding. So assuming your project meets the rest of the criteria, you can come to us and we can look at it.
Third, one Union Bank, just sorry, my practical problem is like a time layer.
Sure.
One is a reality company. This is a Union Bank ka 32 crore tha, maine 6 de diya, 24. Puri kahani 2013 se PIL dakal, wetland ka, jo aaj High Court ne order diya Katawal ji ko, ke do hafta mein ready karo. Ye humare jitne bhi project pass hue, ya jo bhi latak gaye, only government licensing 2013 se late hone se, aaj 7 saal ho gaya. Problem hamara hota hai ki NPA ho gaya as a builder developer. Baki log to NPA ho hi rahe, koi performance nahi kar rahe, to humare pe kab tak ye NPA ka lagta rahega tabba.
तो सर आपका क्वेश्चन क्या था मैं समझा
क्वेश्चन यही था सर बाकी लोग प्रमोट नहीं जैसे खिलाड़ी है तीन मैच में नहीं आउट सिर्फ अपन तीन बार आउट हो गया जीरो हो गया तो भी खेलने का मौका मिलता है बाकी हर जगह पे मेहता दो बार हार जाते राहुल जी 17 बार तो भी उसको खेलने का मौका मिलता है बिल्डर 3 महीना लेट हो जाता है तो क्या एनपीए हो जाता है
सर आई डोंट रिप्रेजेंट द गवर्नमेंट
नो
तो आई
यू नो मेरा कहना है सबको चांस
मैं जानता नहीं मैं क्या आंसर दे सकता
काजी साहब कोई बात नहीं सबको चांस मिलता है तो बिल्डर एक बार फेल होता है जो आप ट्रस्ट किया है जिस तरह से आप फंड लाए 5 साल लेट लाए लेकिन जागे तो साला अच्छी बात है आने वाले 5 साल नए एनपीए नहीं हुए तो थैंक यू गवर्नमेंट लेट सही लेकिन फिर से स्टार्ट किया धन्यवाद सबको फिर से मौका मिले थैंक यू सर
थैंक यू
Okay, because the sales and redevelopment both are in the one formula.
So any project where there are sales, and therefore MADA redevelopment project, etc. But it has to be a RERA registered project, so there have to be new sales in that project. It is not just resettlement of existing tenants.
Okay, one more thing.
So there has to be some sale component in the project.
The sales component is there. In case if there are any litigations in the project, so what about it?
So we look at litigations, this, if there are RERA related litigations, we can look at it,
okay.
Right? But if there are other litigations, let's say there's a title dispute going on in the courts. I'm just giving an example. If there's that kind of a judicial dispute going on, then, you know, there is no reason why we can look at that investment.
Okay. So title and society clearance, you have to get all the things clear.
So we will do our own due diligence to establish all that. But when you come to us, you have to tell us. If you tell us there is a pending judicial dispute,
yeah.
Right? So then, you know, it doesn't make sense. How does money come in and help if there is a dispute happening?
Okay. Thank you.
A lot of people might also be interested in how does the process work?
Sure.
Yeah, how do you apply? I mean, once you apply, how does generally the process between...
So let me tell you the process, like I was telling Mr. Jain, the process does not work by calling me and telling me, suna hai, government mein fund launch kiya hai. Right? That's not the way the process works. What we did is, because we were getting too many calls, we revamped our website completely. So sbicapventures.com. All the information that you need is there on the website. You know, we have a comprehensive, frequently asked question kind of a list. That is there on the website also. The format in which data has to be submitted to us is there on the website. And we've kept it simple. So, now, assuming you know your project, it shouldn't take more than 10 minutes to complete the data. We've also posted the email ID, so you can email directly from that website to us. We will get the information. Try not to call us on the same day, but we will review the information. We will get back to you. And, you know, in what happens is we get a lot of emails, and seriously, there are emails which say, you know, again, the English equivalent of Suna Hai Government Fund Launch Care, which is, can you send us some details about your fund, right? Instead of applying to us, they want us to, you know, become pen friends with them. So that is not the intention. You send us information. My team will then get in touch with you. We'll do a basic sanity check to see if it meets the criteria. If it seems to be meeting the criteria, or if there is, you know, for some reason, some information gap, we will get in touch with you.
Mr. Kazi, thank you. My question is that, as I understand from a presentation, that it has to be a brownfield project and should not be a greenfield project. And assuming that there is a project where is the substantial portion is a land cost which is incurred, let us assume that 25-26% is a land cost which is incurred, and some 3-4% of a construction cost is incurred, and there are some customers into it. Is it right to assume basically that it will fit into a criteria of the 30% of project cost incurred, and therefore basically project is qualified to apply for the funding from this fund?
So as long as 30% of the cost is incurred, whether it's land cost, infra cost or whatever, as long as the project has been launched and there is some home buyer interest involved, we can look at it. It doesn't matter. So we are not looking at physical progress, you know, 3 floors have to be constructed, superstructure has to be in place, nothing of that sort. If the project is launched and, you know, there are X number of home buyers already stuck in the project, we could look at it.
Thank you. The second question is, thank you for detailing out the process for applying to the fund. But generally speaking, it's like once the application is made in the right format and the right form, how much time you expect basically the application to be, you know, disposed of in terms of taking a decision, whether it can be funding or should be funded? What should, in your opinion, will be a sort of a right kind of a time frame?
So I'll tell you our process, right? What we do is when we get your data, we first, you know, try to do a sanity check on the numbers, try to establish whether is this. Then it's a question of the quality of the information we get, the questions we ask, the kind of information we get. You know, sales MIS, cost incurred, CA certificate on cost incurred, etc., etc. We have a two-tier process. So what we do is we first take it to our investment committee and get an in-principle approval. Before that, we'll ask you, you know, maybe not a million questions, slightly less than that, to get all the details about your project. We will, you know, form our proposal verbatim on the basis of what you've told us, right? So you tell us it's 2 acres of land, you know, 100,000 square feet of construction, whatever. We'll rely on that. We'll prepare our, you know, financial model. We'll prepare our IC note. We'll take it to our investment committee. We'll get the in-principle approval. That's stage one approval. We will then do an external due diligence, right? So some agency, some property consultant will actually look at your papers to determine the land size, to determine the FSI applicable, etc., etc. Some financial audit firm will go through the SPV or the holding company financials to find out, you know, the conditions of the financials in the last, let's say, 1 or 2 years. Some legal firm will go through all your contractual documents to understand what are the liabilities in your documents. Once that external due diligence is done, we will change our note, our financial model accordingly based on, you know, what we finally establish as something that has been verified and certified by a third party. And we will again go to our investment committee for a final approval. When we get that final approval, we'll do the documentation to disburse. The entire procedure, depending on the quality of information we get, could be between 40 to maybe 60 days. So maybe 2 months, actually maybe longer also if the information flow is very poor. But on an average, we are looking at about 45 days to you know, completely process an application. Sorry? By that, do you mean that is the promoter going to provide anything? Yeah. So when we are looking at net worth, in our internal analysis and the amount of debt we can provide, amount of NCD financing we can provide, we are looking at our cover, financial cover that we are getting. There is no magic number on that cover. That cover depends on, you know, is it an early stage project? It's a late stage project. What is the sales velocity in the past? What is the expected sales velocity in the future? So it's a very judgmental number. Net worth positive is the qualification criteria, right?
So what will be the security cover for this? Any mortgage security?
So we are looking at cash cash flow cover only. Obviously, the underlying assets of the project will be charged to us. We'll have a senior charge. In fact, our operating rule is, at least what was charged to the previous lender will be charged to us.
No other collaterals or any guarantees, personal guarantees?
So there is no hard and fast rule for anything. But for example, other collaterals, there are transactions where you have to pay, you have to give other collaterals. Gotcha. It is not across transactions. Personal guarantees, I think that's there in almost all lending transactions. So that will be there.
One more question. Since the mode of funding is debentures, can partnership firms, LLPs approach for this funding?
So, it is slightly difficult for partnership firms to issue NCDs. We are taking some legal opinion to see how we could do it. So, you know, it means some amount of financial structuring, making an SPV in between, having that SPV this, but it's not the ideal route. So what we are doing is we are prioritizing. We are doing the easy part first. We are doing the part where there are a larger number of home buyers first. We are receiving proposals across the country from where 5 home buyers are involved to where 500 home buyers are involved. So we are looking at the 500 home buyers first, and therefore we'll not look at LLPs or partnerships immediately. We'll look at the other structures first. But it's only a question of prioritizing. It's not saying no.
Hi sir, good evening.
Good evening.
Basically, there is a question for you that you talked about a phased project in which you have 5 different buildings. Can you do, and each of them is a differently rare or restricted project, can it be availed on 3 of the buildings rather than all the 5 buildings?
Yes, absolutely.
So you can apply like for an individual project rather than a project as a whole?
Yeah, so the only thing we'll take we'll look at the larger picture on what's happening on the rest of the project. So supposing you have 3 buildings which are in various states of completion, there are home buyers in all the 3 buildings, and you come to us for funding for 2 buildings, right? There has to be a good reason why the 3rd building is being excluded or included for that matter. That's the only call we'll take. Otherwise, yes, we can look at it. We can look at 1 building. We can look at all 3 buildings.
And the future sales that will be done, you'll be requiring, you need to take the NOCs for the every sale of flat.
Like any other lender would.
Lastly, sir, also one thing, most of the projects that is being funded right now, are you looking for like tier 1, tier 2 cities? Do you have bifurcations for them or just
no.
larger numbers?
No, so we are looking at across India and we are looking at, so we are only prioritizing it on the basis of number of home buyers. It's not like this is a fund for large cities or and not for small cities or anything like that. We are looking at projects across India.
Thanks, sir. And last question, this will be a single tranche or debenture or it will be like phase-wise investments?
So the biggest mistake we could make is, give the entire debenture amount in a single tranche. That will not happen. It will be linked to, what we call internally physical progress. Not progress in numbers, but physical progress. So as we see the building coming up, more and more money will be disbursed. It will be in several tranches. Completely linked to the pace of construction.
Okay. Thank you.
Sir, kuch farak nahi padta hai. Criteria se, whether it's MMR, NCR, doesn't matter. We will look at the project. Sir, lagega hi. RERA ka requirement bhi yahi hai ki you had a 6-month or a 1-year period for getting RERA registration. Sir, toh hum log kaisa karenge? I'm just thinking on my feet here. I really don't have a very, very this. But we'll exclude those 2 apartments. Dohi apartment hai. Usko hamare consideration se nikal denge. Not for cash flow cover, not for construction, not for anything.
Sir, aise 200 flat hai, jo mere, jahan mujhe 100 crore chukana hai, uski payment kimat mano 300 hai. Mere purane 400 building bani hai. Usme se 300 flat nikal denge, toh cash flow surplus nahi aayega. Mera point aap se apply karne se pehle, jitni building bani usi hai, sabko usko nikal denge, inventory kam ho jayegi. Uske liye kaisa karna
hai? Sir, fir RERA registration required hai. Yeah. If you want us to consider it, or error registration charge.
Sir, one question. Is your funding available for SRA scheme?
Yeah.
Okay, one more. And can the society be an applicant for getting this fund?
So, honestly, it does not matter. As long as there is a company or a SPV that is going to issue the debentures, as long as we are getting assets, we are getting a charge on the assets, it does not matter who applies to us.
Okay, so just...
But we have to see that there is a developer already.
But if the developer is behind bars, he is not able to just come up behind, he is not able to come up out of the prison. So what in that case?
So what you have to do then in such cases, and there are, I'm not saying of the behind bar cases, but let's say, you know, for whatever reason, you want to change the developer involved. Right?
Yeah.
You want to change it. We don't want to. You want to change. You complete the story.
Okay.
Get the developer, get into an arrangement with the developer, economics, etc. Complete the story and then come to us.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
So, in case we have an existing SPV where the majority of the shares, it's a partnership firm, the majority of the partnership ratio is with a private limited company. So can they approach SWAMIH for that? Because you said partnership firms.
The asset, where is the asset in the partnership firm or in the company behind it?
So if I'm talking about a MADA project, there's a development agreement, which is with the partnership firm. And a private limited company would be a major shareholder, I mean in the partnership firm. So in that case, can they approach for this fund?
We'll have to see. On the face of it, there might be some issues because we have to see which is the entity that is issuing the debentures.
Mm-hmm.
Is it the company? Is it the partnership firm?
So, but if the private limited company is ready to take the NCDs in its name and use the funds specifically for the SPV, is there a way for it?
My only inhibition there is the asset is not owned by the private limited company. So, we'll then have to take a legal view on, you know, what kind of development rights the private limited company has.
Yeah, because existing already we have lenders who have taken the cash flows of the SPV and the loan has actually been destroyed.
Who are your existing lenders?
Edelweiss.
Okay.
So they have given loans to the private limited company and the cash flows are actually mortgaged with them and the funds are actually to be utilized for the SPV.
So on the face of it, it might be possible.
Because you just said that partnerships and LLPs would not be getting a chance.
So that's where, so that is actually the solution to it.
Okay.
You know, an SPV is created,
hmm.
Which holds the partnership interest.
Correct.
So that's the structuring, which is the first line of remedy for, getting an NCD into a partnership of this.
Okay.
So we could look at it, but you know, if you send me some papers, send me some details.
Okay.
Just run it past the fund lawyers also.
Okay.
So what would happen like in case the funding have been done and 50% of the project was sold and till the time the project is completed, no more buyers comes in the project. And like the situation is the same only, that it's 50% sold. At that point of time, like what would be the situation? It's a very... worst case scenario, but then also just...
No, no. So, we are looking at a lot of projects which are even more sold, 90% sold and so on.
Right.
Right? So, that's fine. That does not matter. As long as the money that is to come into the project from the sales sold receivables and the unsold inventory is greater than the cost to complete the project and the cost of financing our debt, we are okay with it.
Yeah. No. So, my question was like, for instance, this like 90% of the project is being sold.
Yeah.
10% is not sold and this 10% inventory remains till the end the project get completed. So till these 10% is sold, whatever the fund which have been received from the 90% ones have not been recovered, the SBI CAP fund is not been recovered, like 5% of the fund is yet to be recovered. So till then that time those 10% of the unsold inventory would going to remain with SBI CAP. It would be like that.
So hopefully that will not happen.
Yeah,
what we are looking at is...
Yeah, it would not going to happen.
What we are looking at is, we'll come in, we'll provide the funding for construction. we will give the project 3, 4, 5 years after the construction is complete to sell it, right? And you know, at some point in time, with some price resets, we hope that the entire inventory will be sold, or at least enough inventory is sold to recover our money back. And then, you know, it's your call what to do with the rest of the inventory.
Right. Second was, sir, for the way of calculating the net worth, the positive net worth, we have taken the unsold inventory. We have taken the money to be received from the unsold inventory and the cost to be met out for the construction activities.
Yeah.
Do we need to put in place the existing lender loan amount also?
No.
For the...
So that's very important. Mm-hmm. And you know, that's what I emphasize on when I say cost of financing our debt. That's it.
That's it.
Whether the cash flow is enough to service the other debts, repay the other debts, mm-hmm. is somebody else's problem.
Okay. And just a question linked to it. For example, there is a consortium of 5 bankers who is there in place to fund this project. So all these 5 need to give an written okay to
yeah.
come.
So all the 5 bankers will be signatories to our integrated arrangement. And through that, they'll give a NOC to us coming in and providing the senior funding.
And if one of them says no, then we won't be able to move forward with this.
True.
So, in Kolkata, it's like not RERA, it's HERA.
Yeah.
So, would we be, in our presentation, Kolkata was there out of those 7 cities. But in all practical purpose, that HERA registered project would be...
not considered.
Will not be considered. So... For like West Bengal, we would not be able to consider.
So it's not just West Bengal. There are some, you know, a couple of other states
where
there are some this on, you know, RERA implementation.
Right.
We are in, for this fund, it needs to necessarily be a RERA registered project.
Okay. So HERA would not be?
HERA would not be.
Suffice. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
So one more last question. Sorry.
So it's a like a big project in which like there is a commercial area also. So that is if more than 10%, then we have to leave that part of that commercial project, or like we can cover just where it's a part of that project. How would like this would be?
So what we look at is slicing and dicing the project so that we are looking at only the residential portion.
Right.
If the, you know, if it's one building with residential, one building with commercial, that's easy.
Right.
If it is 3 floors of commercial and then residential above that, that is very difficult.
Right.
So unless those 3 floors are already built, unless the cost is already provided for, we cannot think of completing the rest of the building. So it is possible that in some projects, the let's say the commercial portion might be more than 10%. But if it's separate from the residential, then we can look at the residential bit.
So we need to leave that commercial area there
yeah.
in that case.
And you know, assuming it does not affect your OC, etc., which it shouldn't.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
To the program. Thank you, Mr. Kazi, for the wonderful presentation and the wonderful clarification that you had made so politely and taking time to come here. As a token of appreciation, we would like to give you a green certificate. May I call Mr. Dharmesh Jain sir to give away.
So once again, as Sadish said, I think a big thank you to Mr. Kazi. And if you have any further questions, do write to us at MCHI. We'll take your queries to Mr. Kazi and his team and try and give you whatever replies you need. But once again, I think it's a wonderful effort by the government. And Mr. Kazi is so impressed by the detailing of the presentation and how much clarity you had. I'm sure, as I said in my opening remarks, thousands of flat owners and hundreds of projects, and a lot of developers are going to benefit out of this. And most importantly, I think people will get the dream home that they've been waiting for. So once again, a big thank you. And as I said, we at MCHI would love to work shoulder to shoulder with you and make this a reality in the earliest possible time frame. Thank you very much once again.